life would be like if the goodness of God's grace hadn't found you. I shudder to think what other path my life would have taken had I not found the cross. The direction my life may have gone in if it had been left up to David to make the choice of where he was going to go. But God was good. God is so good to us. Hallelujah. Let's just lift our hands and just thank Him for His goodness this morning. Father, God, You are good, Father. God, You are faithful, Lord. God, let this be a church, God, that's not ashamed to jump and shout and thank You, Father, for what You've done for us, God. That Your mercy and Your grace were shed upon us, Father. The remembrance of the cross we celebrated this morning, God, that You sent, Father God, Your Son, God. You did not spare Your best for us, Father, but You gave us Your best, Father. That Christ would die as a substitute, as a replacement for me, God, that I might be forgiven, Lord. You're good to us, God. You're good to us, Father. And we're not ashamed to tell You of Your goodness, Lord. Hallelujah. Just give Him a shout of praise as you see it. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated. Go ahead and release our children to go be blessed in Jesus' name. I want to tell Antoine, thank you for what he shared. That was powerful. And he said a lot of us aren't as bad as him, and I need to give him a chance to share his testimony. It's powerful. A lot of us in here, I think we know it. Maybe some of us know bits and pieces, but I'd really like to have him come and share it. It's a miracle. It's just a rescue. It's unbelievable that he's even in this room this morning. It's a miracle that he's even here. And but it's God. It's God's faithfulness and God's favor. And so I just want to say I'm proud of him. He's a bold witness. His job allows him to have some liberty and some freedom when he's out working in his different areas that he's assigned to. And God, he tells me so many times of open doors that God leads him to share the gospel and to share his testimony and what God has done for him. So I just want to say how proud I am of you, Antoine, and that you're with us. And so praise God. So hallelujah, I'm excited this morning. You know, we should be excited every time we come together. And, you know, I thought about, you know, as I was preparing this word, you know, some of you might think, well, I wonder what, you know, Pastor David's got to say to us today. And really, it's not what I have to say. It's what does God have to say to us? You know, I'm just a messenger. I'm just an instrument or a mouthpiece for God. But if anybody comes and stands up here and speaks anything other than what the Word of God says, I really don't want to know what they have to say. I came here to hear what God has to say. So in that regard, I believe that should cause us to be excited with enthusiasm and anticipation. It's like, what is God going to say to me today, right? So that's hopefully what we'll do. But I'm excited today. I believe that this message, I'm hoping that some people are going to get set free today. I believe it's something that all of us can relate to. And when you read the Bible, it's amazing when you read the Bible, especially the New Testament, and you read the teachings of Christ, how everything that Christ taught, all of us can identify with. We can relate to the things that Christ said. And we know the Bible was written over 2,000 years ago. So it's pretty remarkable that I can pick up a book today in 2019 and still relate to what it was that Christ taught and the words that were written so long ago. So I just find that so powerful. But you read the teachings of Christ. He taught about loving others, about forgiveness. He taught us about judging others. The story of the Samaritan woman, he taught us about emptiness and loneliness and discontentment. He taught us about the deceit of riches and wealth. All these different things that Christ taught about, every one of us can say, you know what? I can understand that. I can identify with that because that affects my life. And Jesus had the ability to do that because he was our creator. God created us, the Bible says. So therefore, God knows us. He knows our lives, our hearts, and all that we're about. But there's one subject in the Bible that Christ taught about that every single person in the world can relate to. And everybody in this room this morning can relate to. There are millions of dollars spent on this problem. Medical agencies and clinics have given it a name. They call it, the medical community calls it a disorder. And they do that a lot with things that the Bible calls sin. But what I'm talking about is worry and anxiety. And I've pulled up a statistic here. It says anxiety disorders affect 18.1% of adults in the United States. That's approximately 40 million adults between the ages of 18 to 54. So I believe worry and anxiety is a subject that every one of us can identify with. And so I titled the message today, Winning the War on Worry. Winning the War on Worry. And I know, and we'd be lying if we disagree with this, that every one of us contends with this issue. We battle this in some form or some fashion, either now in our lives or at some point in our lives, we have dealt with the issue of anxiety and worry. One of the definitions I pulled up was apprehensive uneasiness or nervousness, to fret or stress about something impending or anticipated. But I like to think of it like this, to anticipate the outcome of something before it happens. In other words, I'm worried or I'm anxious about something, and usually the thing I'm worried about or anxious about has yet to even happen. But I'm still worried about it. but it hasn't even happened yet. But we're very anxious about it. So worry and anxiety, and this came up with the stats that I was looking at, is not limited to just adults. And I can remember myself at a young age, especially when I was in school. I think some of y'all, I might have shared this with y'all, I hated school. I couldn't stand school. I applied myself. I studied. I did all the things that the teachers would ask me to do, but I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand the testing, the thinking about, what are they going to ask me? What if it's a question that she or he didn't tell me in the class and they're going to give me like a surprise question? I ain't going to know what the answer is. I got all worked up about it and worried about it. But this may sound hard to believe, but I can actually remember a time when I was worried in my mama's womb. There was another person with me inside the womb. And I can remember looking at that other person, and I was extremely worried that when I came out, I was going to look like the other person in my mother's womb. No, I mean this. I'm not joking about this. But I'm here to tell you, after I was born, I realized my worry didn't come true. That's a true story. It is true. I have a twin brother, for those of y'all who don't know, and praise God, we're not identical. But anyway, worry and anxiety affects every one of us. And I believe some of us actually carry around our worry and our anxiety as if it's something for us to be proud of. Like it's something that I can say, like this is something that I do, that I contribute, this is the part that I play. And we almost wear it as a badge of honor, as if to say, I'm proud of the fact that I have anxiety or that I worry. And that cannot be further from the truth of what the Word of God says. See, we feel like when we worry, when I'm worried about something, it means that I'm more concerned about what it is I'm worried about. Take, for example, your children. If I worry about my children, then that means as a parent, I am more concerned about my children. I care more because I'm worried. We may not say that, but that's what we're saying when we worry about our children. We wear it as something to be proud of. But anxiety, like every other sin that humans deal with, are given names. And like I said, the medical community calls it an anxiety disorder. But if you read the Bible, the Bible actually says that worry and anxiety is a sin. It's something that the Bible speaks very, very strongly about. So, but the problem with worry and anxiety is that it affects the church just as much as it affects the world. In other words, the believer, those of us who claim to know Christ, who claim to know what the Word of God says, we struggle with anxiety and worry just as much as the unbeliever does. I don't believe in every regard, but I believe in many regards. I know from my experience, it seems to be just as prevalent in the church as it is in the world. And obviously that shouldn't be the case because of what the Word of God says. So we can read plenty of scriptures. I'm just going to read this one as an example of what the Word of God says to the believer. This is in Psalm chapter 91. It says, "Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from deadly disease. He will cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side, though 10,000 are dying around you, these evils will not touch you." Now, I believe every Christian, when they read that, I believe every believer would say, "I believe that. I believe what that Word of God says, that God is my protector, that God is my defender, that God is my shield, that God is with me." But the question we have to ask ourselves is, if that scripture, if those scriptures are true, what are we worried about? Why do we allow worry and anxiety to come into our lives? And unfortunately, a lot of us, if we were honest with ourselves, we worry about a lot of things. More things than what I think we really care to say we worry about. And I know for me, sometimes I like to say, well, you know, the excuse I'll give it is I'm not really worried about it. I'm just thinking about it, right? How many ever said, "I ain't worried, I'm just thinking"? Well, if you're thinking about it, you're worried about it. I can't stop thinking about it. No, you can't stop worrying about it. You see that? And I do that sometimes. I'll say, well, you know, and we have to draw the line with this. It's not wrong for us to plan and to do things in advance for purposes of things that we're doing in our life. That's not what the Bible is saying. But it is wrong for us to work ourselves up in a spirit of anxiety and worry. So what I'm asking you today is, are we going to accept that worry and anxiety is normal behavior? There was that, and I believe some of us, maybe we haven't done it deliberately, but I believe some of us have just accepted the fact, you know what? I can't help it. I'm going to worry. This is one thing I'm just going to have to deal with in my life, and I can't let go of it. But that's a lie from the devil, because that's not what the Bible says. See, that may be what the world thinks, and the world wants to slap a name on it so they can give it a title so they can say, yes, this is a disorder that you have. It's okay. You have to deal with this disorder that you have. No, we don't have to deal with it. We can be free of it in Jesus' name. That's what the Word of God says. So I'm believing that today, not that God is going to say something to you and then you're going to make a decision another time away from today. No, today. Let God say this. Let the Lord say, today I'm going to free you of this spirit of anxiety and worry. That God wants to do that for us. So we can just say, I can't help it. Or are you going to say, I want to win the war on worrying? Because it is a war. It's a battle. Again, every one of us, I believe, I don't care how old you are. And there's even people downstairs in the children's church, some of our children, they deal with anxiety. They deal with issues of worry. So every one of us, I believe, can identify with this subject. The question we have to ask ourselves is, am I going to just accept the fact that I'm going to just live with this for the rest of my life? Or am I going to believe what the Word of God says, that I truly can be delivered from this? I believe you can be delivered. I believe every one of us in here can be delivered from this in Jesus' name, because that's God's promise to us. That's his design and his desire for us. So we're going to look at and there's no better person to go to on matters of this subject than Jesus himself. In other words, he's the master, he's the Lord. And again, when we read these scriptures, just imagine how amazing this is that Christ could speak with such clarity, with such simple words, with such powerful words, that when we read this, I can say, you know what? I relate to that. That is me. Like, when I'm reading that, I'm thinking, that's me. Every bit it is. So let's look at what Christ said here in Matthew chapter 6. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. That's powerful. That's being spoken right from the throne room of heaven. That's the words of God himself spoken through Jesus Christ. But as I read this passage, the first thing that I notice in this is that Jesus doesn't give us a 12-step program to conquer anxiety. He doesn't sit there and try to list all the ways that it's going to take, or all the steps that you're going to have to take to try to try to conquer anxiety. No, rather he flips the script on anxiety and exposes its emptiness and reveals the waste of time and energy we spend on it. In other words, instead of trying to tell you how to be delivered from this, he is basically exposing the deception of anxiety, that it is a complete and total waste of time. And we're gonna look at that. So sometimes exposing the truth about something we deal with is more powerful than giving us a program to try to escape it. If I really understand what it is I'm dealing with, sometimes that's all the power I need. Just tell me what this thing's really all about. And that's exactly what it is that Christ did in this passage. Jesus is telling us that worry is not worth the time worrying about. That's really what he's telling us. So let's break this down here. The first thing that he's telling us is worry places value of things in life above our life. In verse 25, it says, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Now, obviously, when Jesus was speaking this, and I've thought of this, when he's talking about don't worry about what you're going to eat and don't worry about what you're going to wear, I believe when he was speaking these words to the people at that time, they probably really were worried about what they were going to eat, as like, where's my next meal going to come from? Or as like clothes, am I really going to be able to afford to buy clothes? You got to remember, this is 2,000 years ago. There wasn't like a McDonald's on every corner and a store, you know, retail store selling clothes. They didn't have all of that. But this scripture passage can still identify with this. And obviously, there are places in the world today where people do still struggle to actually say, am I going to have enough food to eat? Or am I going to have enough money to purchase clothes to wear? But here's where you and I fit into this, I believe. We worry maybe not whether we're going to eat, but we worry about what we're going to eat, right? We're consumed. We're consumed about that. And sometimes food or the consumption of food or the idea of food sometimes can consume us. We're occupied with the worry of thinking about food. And then when it comes to clothes, and this is probably more so of the younger generation, but maybe it can also affect the older generation as well. But when we think of clothing, we're more, okay, I'm going to have clothes, but we're worried about the fashion or the style or the type of clothes that we're going to wear. And I believe this is what Christ is talking about. We spend our time, we occupy our time and effort on the things of our lives, but not our lives ourselves. Do you understand what I'm saying? We're more worried about the things of life than my life, like who I am. And that's what Jesus is referring to. See, we put little value on life itself. Jesus is telling us, concern yourself with your life. Not the things of your life, but your life yourself. What things of your life? Well, Christ spoke about the heart. Jesus spent a lot of times talking about the heart. He said that what comes out of a person's mouth reveals what's in a person's heart. The things that come out of the mouth of a man, the Bible says that's what defiles him, because Christ says what comes out of your mouth reveals what's in your heart. But that's hard for a lot of us to say, because there's a lot of wicked things that come out of our mouths. And we don't want to agree that, you know what, that was in my heart. But that's what Jesus said. Be concerned about your heart. Be concerned about your mind. Be concerned about your body, your soul. Be concerned with the things that matter, like the eternity of your soul. Be concerned with eternal life. Be concerned with those things. Not trivial things like food and clothes. Jesus said in another passage, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Notice, what would it profit a man if he spent his whole life consumed and concerned about all the other things in the world that don't really matter, but he neglected the only one thing that really did matter, which was his soul? Jesus said, what would it profit his man, that man? But then he shows us the real life illustration to prove this point in verse 26. He said, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Last time I checked, I don't think there's any bird groups around here that have a 401k. There ain't no animals out there worried about saving money or storing food. But the point that Christ was trying to make here is that God already knows you need these things. In other words, you're worried about things that God already knows you need, and therefore God is going to provide those things. And then he says, the birds and the animals, they are provided for, but Christ says, are you not much more valuable than they? Well, of course you are. God created human beings, the Bible says, in his likeness. We are much more valuable than they are. So Christ, see what he's trying to say? He's trying to show us the foolishness. This is the revelation that God gave me when I was reading. I've read this passage 100 times. The foolishness and the waste of worrying. What Christ is trying to say is God already knows. And here's how I'm going to tell you he already knows. The birds, they are fed every day, but they don't go out and work and store and save and do all these things, but God provides for them. How much more will God not provide for you? See, but the devil, the enemy, tries to deceive us and to lie to us and to hide who God really is in our lives and get us to think that, you know, God doesn't care. God's not concerned. Yes, he is. You are more valuable than a bird. Now, there are some people out there that don't believe that. There really is. And I'm not going to get on that because Ray might get upset with me, but we are more valuable than birds. If God takes care of them, how much more is God going to take care of us? See, Jesus, he didn't give us the steps to cure anxiety. He gave us the reality of what anxiety is all about. He exposed it. He exposed the deception of worry and anxiety. the forest, the deception of it. See, when you worry about these things, you are placing more value on them than on your life. You are telling God that these things are more valuable than life itself. And you are neglecting the fact that the Lord will provide these things regardless of your worth and value. The next thing that Christ shows us in this, in verse 27, it says, can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? So the next thing I think we need to see is worry is a colossal waste of time and energy. See, the world and you have got together in agreement, and you have basically made the conclusion that worrying is helping your situation. That is my contribution to helping my situation. And we feel like if I don't worry, my situation is not going to get better. But Jesus comes along and says, which one of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? In other words, what difference did it make when you decided to worry? And how powerful is that Christ spoke that? That which of you can add a single moment to your life? See, although worry and anxiety is not a disorder, one thing the medical community has proven, anxiety does affect your health. And my wife can testify to this, especially when she worked in a hospital. She saw this firsthand with some of the patients that she dealt with. But Proverbs 17 says, a joyful, cheerful heart brings healing to both body and soul. But the one whose heart is crushed struggles with sickness and depression. Do you realize that anxiety and worry can actually make you sick? And Lori, my wife, as a nurse, she can prove that medically, that is a proven fact. That the anxiety and worry in a person's life can actually have an impact on that person's physical health. But the Bible says a joyful, cheerful heart brings healing. See, that's a peaceful heart. That's a content heart. That's a heart who's trusting God. So we think that worry is helping our situation, but really Jesus is telling us that worry is doing absolutely nothing to help your situation and everything to hurt it. You're not helping your situation at all. So have you ever asked yourself this question? I've done this before. What difference would it have made in my situation whether I would have or wouldn't have worried about it? Would it have changed the outcome of my situation? Have you ever asked yourself that question? I do it all the time. And the answer I always get is nothing. It would have made absolutely no difference at all on the outcome of my situation. See, but we've convinced ourselves that somehow worrying is helping the situation when actually you're hurting the situation. You're hurting yourself, the Bible says. It shows that you're not trusting in God. So Jesus said, can one of you by worrying add a single hour to your life? In other words, can your worry make any positive difference in your life whatsoever? No. Worrying has none. It cannot help us at all. So Jesus again gives us the example of worrying when he says, the birds are fed and the lilies of the field are clothed. Christ is telling us if God cares about the grass in the field and the lilies in the field and the birds in the air, how much more is Christ concerned about us? So I believe what Jesus is saying is you are wasting your time and energy on anxiety and worry. It's a waste of time. He is telling us it is a colossal waste of time. It will not change your situation. So this I believe is important for us to get, because the enemy, see, it's the Lord is not trying to get us to worry, but the devil is trying to come in and get you to worry and get you to be anxious. But Jesus comes along and he pulls the curtain back from what worry is all about, and he says, see, this is the deception. Worry does you nothing. It does not change your situation. That was a revelation for me. God wants us to be free of this. How many of y'all really want to be free of worry and anxiety? I want to be free of that. I don't want to spend my time, wasting my time on something that will make no difference. Jesus is trying to make the point, what are you worried about? Why are you worried? The birds are taken care of. The grass is clothed better than you are. They're not worried. They're not storing things, buying things. Yet God cares for them. It is, as you got to remember, the Bible says that Jesus was the Son of Man and the Son of God. So he's standing on earth as the Son of Man, but he also was the Son of God, the Bible says. So here he is standing on the earth. He knows the Heavenly Father. Jesus knows the provision of the Heavenly Father. He knows everything that the Father has for us. So now Jesus is like standing on planet earth, surrounded by all of his creation, and Jesus is observing, no doubt, the worry and anxiety of those around him, and he's scratching his head like, what are you worried about? Like, I can picture him doing this, like standing like I got, like God the Father. Like God the Father's going to feed you. God the Father's going to clothe you. He's going to provide for you. What are you worried about? And he tells us the pagans, that's what the pagans run after. We're not pagans here. We're God-fearing, God-loving people. We honor God. We trust God. But the Bible says when we enter and engage in fear and worry and anxiety, we side ourselves with the ungodly. I want to live my life as a witness of a godly testimony that I trust that God is my provider, that he is the one that is with me. And then the next thing that Jesus is telling us in Matthew chapter 6, verse 31, he says, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So the next thing we need to look at is don't worry, seek God. Don't worry, seek God instead. And y'all, some of you might remember that song that came out. Remember, it said, don't worry, be happy. That doesn't work either. That's not gonna solve anxiety, I promise you. But this will. Don't worry, seek God. See, this is the only place in the passage where Jesus really gives us the answer to the anxiety, quote, disorder that the world has labeled this as. But it's really not a cure. It's a declaration. Jesus has given us a declaration to make, to quit worrying about the things the world worries about and instead place your time and energy seeking the things of God. What a substitute, what a replacement if you and I could get that. See, he's not giving us a 12-step program. It's really a 2-step revelation. Quit worrying and start seeking. Imagine if we did this, and I'm going to try this. I really am. Every time I am tempted to worry about anything in my life, in that very moment, I'm going to do what this verse of Scripture says, and I'm going to begin to seek God. If I have to fall on my face at the moment, I'm like, God, I'm seeking you right here. God, show me your face. God, show me your favor. God, show me your love. God, show me your mercy. God, I'm seeking you in this. What would that do to free us if every time we were tempted to worry, instead of worrying, we would seek the face of God? I believe every one of us in here would shout and say, you know what? I got delivered from that. I was free. What Jesus is saying is, don't worry about all the things God already knows you have need of, whatever it is in your life, but seek first God. Put God first in your life, and all these things will be added unto you as well. What a promise. What a promise that God has for us. And I can tell you that God is faithful to that promise. I quote that scripture many a times when people are struggling with direction or understanding of what God is doing or what it is that God is trying to place in their life or what direction they want to go in and what do I do. I always quote that scripture. I say, listen, I don't know how it is that God's going to provide the answer for you, but I know he will. But the Bible says if you seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, all these things will be added to you as well. That's a promise. But to get the promise, you got to do what the promise says. You got to put God first. You got to seek him, not second. Not the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So I'm going to put that into practice. I'm going to begin to seek the Lord's goodness. We sang that song. What a beautiful song that we sang of the Lord's goodness. I'm going to begin to seek the Lord's provision. See, a lot of anxiety comes in because we think we're not going to have enough. There's not enough to pay the bills. There's not enough. There's not enough. There's not enough. God's enough. God's more than enough. The Bible says the Lord is Jehovah Jireh. He's your provider. God will provide for you. Why don't you begin to seek the Lord's provision next time you want to worry or be anxious? Begin to seek the Lord's mercy. Begin to seek the Lord's favor. Tell the Lord how faithful He's been to you. Seek the Lord's majesty, His peace, and His joy. How about that for a substitute for worry? I believe that'll set a lot of us free if we did that. And then in verse 34, Jesus says, "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." The next thing Christ wants us to see is tomorrow will worry about tomorrow. Again, this is the words of God. This is the very voice of God speaking to us. And Jesus is telling us, why are you worried about tomorrow? Tomorrow has yet to come. Tomorrow has not happened yet. Tomorrow may not even come for some of us. We don't know what God's design or what His plan is for any of our lives. Why are you worried about something that has yet to even happen yet? And then He says something that is so profound. Each day has enough trouble of its own. In other words, you need to occupy and concern yourself with the things that are happening today. Because today's going to throw you enough to be concerned about. Don't waste your time about tomorrow. Let tomorrow worry about tomorrow. How freeing is that? See, these are the words of Christ. This is what Christ is telling us. Imagine going into some of these medical clinics where these people are dealing with this anxiety disorder and reading the scripture to them, how eye-opening that would be to them to get a revelation of what God says, that you are being deceived and you are being robbed, that you are wasting your time worrying. The words of Christ are so powerful, but they're so simple. We can identify with every word that Christ said in this passage. Every one of us in this room can say, you know what? I identify with that. I worry about tomorrow. Some of you are worried about things 10 years from now, 5 years from now. 10 years from now may never come. You don't know what your life's going to be in 10 years. Be thankful God has given you today. Honor God and serve God today. Live God the best you can the day He's given you today. And then tomorrow when you wake up, tell God, God, I'm thankful for another day. I'm going to live for You this day. Don't let worry and anxiety, see, it's a robber. It robs us. It's deceiving. It's a colossal waste of time. It does you absolutely nothing. It serves no purpose. We, especially those of you who are parents, we feel like, this is my contribution. God, I'm helping you. I'm helping you. See, I care. No, if you cared, you'd trust God. I'm going to trust God. It'll rob you. It'll rob you of your joy. It'll bring fear. All those different things it attach itself to. And you'll live in bondage and it'll enslave you. God wants to free us. To be free. To trust God. Wouldn't that be better? As a substitute for worry, trust. God, I'm going to trust You. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Trust God. Just in all your ways, in every decision, every path, everything that you do, trust the Lord, the Bible says. And He will lead you in the right path. Let me ask Mia to begin playing that song we had. What a refreshing, powerful word spoken by Christ. Again, they're so simple, but they're so powerful and profound. And y'all have heard me say this before, and you gotta remember, when you're reading the Bible and you're reading the words of Christ, you're reading the very words of God. Jesus said, if you've seen Me, you've seen the Father.
We don't need to print another gospel. We don't need to write it a different way. God has given us the plan. He's given us the words of Christ himself. They're very simple, but they're very powerful. You can't add a single minute. You can't add a second to your life by worrying. It's going to do you nothing. God wants to free us in this place today. Don't you want to be free? I want to be free. Stand to your feet, please. I'm going to rebuke the enemy right now in the name of Jesus, because he's going to try to prevent some of you from getting your deliverance today. So, Father, I declare what the Word of God says, that my enemy is defeated in Jesus' name. My enemy has no power over me in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that my enemy is a liar and he is the father of lies. So, Satan, I rebuke you right now in the name of Jesus. I come against you in the name of Jesus. We resist you right now in the name of Jesus. We will not be bound by anxiety and worry. Your deception has been exposed. The curtain has been pulled back, and we realize it has no hold on us. It makes no difference. We want freedom today. We want freedom today in Jesus' name. Praise God. I'm going to have in a moment an opportunity for you to come forward for that. But before I do that, I just want to give an invitation for salvation. The Bible says we're not promised tomorrow. Again, some of you are planning your life. You're planning your life 30 years from now. But the Bible says you don't even know if tomorrow is going to come. But God's got an answer for death. It's called eternal life. And it's found in Jesus Christ. I got a friend of mine. I just got an email this morning from a guy I used to work with in Chalmette. He's only about 4 or 5 years younger than I am. He emailed me this morning and said, "Would you pray for Andy? He's dying." I just ran into him a couple of months ago at Home Depot. Full of life. Jumping. We were reminiscing about some of the things in the past. He said, "Would you pray?" The doctors don't know what he has, and they don't know what to do. He's dying right now. I pray God gives me an opportunity to go and reinforce that, "Andy, do you know Christ? Do you know the Lord?" God's cry to us is, be saved. Be delivered of your greatest enemy, which is death and sin, the Bible says. That's your greatest freedom. See, when I'm saved, I'm delivered from everything, even death. So I'm just going to ask everybody just to bow your head and close your eyes just for a moment. That's you today, and you say, I want to confess Christ as Lord today. I want to invite him into my life. I want to just surrender my life to him. I want to say this simple prayer, which is this: Jesus, I need you. And he loves you so much, he wants to come into your life. But you got to invite him in, the Bible says. So that's you today. You've never said that simple prayer. You've never asked Christ to come in, but you want to do it today. And you say, "Would you pray with me before you go? I would love to pray with you before I go." Slip your hand up for just a second and let me pray with you. Don't leave this place without the knowledge and security of your salvation.